Hi everyone, welcome. I'm Eli, and I just wanted to say thank you for joining us today. Happy Mother's Day to all you mothers out there. This one's super special for me. It's my first Mother's Day ever. To this sweet girl, Riley. Say hi. Hi. Welcome. We just want to connect with you today on this beautiful Sunday at bayfarmchurch.org/connect. Before we worship the Lord through singing, we want to worship Him through sacrificial giving. We believe that giving and offering to the Lord is a form of worship. Go to bayfarmchurch.org/give. See the four ways you can worship God through giving. I just want to give a shout out to my mom because she's in Ohio and I don't get to hug her today. But happy Mother's Day, Mom. I miss you and I love you and I can't wait to see you. This Mother's Day is especially awesome for me because I get to be a mom for the first time this year. Woo! To this special girl, Riley. Riley, come on. Give him a smile. Give him a smile. Hi! So happy Mother's Day and I hope you enjoy your Sunday.
Well, wherever you are this morning, we invite you to worship with us. We're going to jump right into these songs of praise. So please join us wherever you are. We provide the lyrics for you, so you have no excuse. You have to sing along. Join us today.
At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name,
good times and the bad, we have an awesome God that we can worship. And really, it starts to happen when we just lift up our songs to Him. Just our confidence in Him increases. Our trust in Him increases. Our affection for Him increases. So we just invite you to participate. Join us in this song as we worship our God.
Yes, I will.
Okay, thank you, worship band, for bringing us that set. I love music. I always have. It always connects me to God in a way that nothing else can. So I really appreciate all the work you guys put in. Thank you so much for bringing us that set. Well, now we're gonna switch gears and we're gonna prepare our hearts to receive the word. We are going to hear a message from the Lord and from Pastor John. We are in a series called Growing Up. The series has a lot of C's involved in it, and today's C word is conforming. We are to conform our lives around Scripture. It's based out of Romans chapter 12. Pastor John's gonna bring us the message, and we are excited to receive it. Before we do, we're gonna watch a video, and it's gonna talk about our hearts. It's gonna prepare us for the word. Watch this video with me.
There's something written on your heart. It's the guiding force in your life. And when the storms of life come, the writing comes to the surface. Your story and all of its baggage is written on your heart. But there's another story, and God says that we are to write it on our hearts. The Bible, 66 books with over 30,000 verses. Now that sounds like a pretty tall order. But Jesus' life provides the perfect example of Scripture that is etched on the heart. When Jesus is tempted by Satan in the wilderness, his response is straight out of Deuteronomy. On his way to being crucified, Jesus continues to quote Scripture. And finally, as Jesus surrenders his spirit, he quotes Psalm 22. His Father's words were on the front of his mind and on the tip of his tongue at every moment. But Jesus didn't just know the Scriptures, he lived the Scriptures. They weren't just words on a page to him. They were the foundation upon which he built his life. And God invites us to do the same. But Jesus said something pretty shocking about the Scriptures. He confronted a group of religious leaders who were trying to earn eternal life by studying the Scriptures and said to them, "You're looking in the wrong place. The Scriptures all point to one thing, me, For I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So don't think that the scriptures lead to eternal life. They don't. They lead to Jesus, the author of eternal life. And studying them is not about knowing a bunch of nice sayings. It's about knowing a person, Jesus. To know Jesus is to know Scripture. And to know Scripture is to know the heart of the Father. For it contains the very words of God. His words were meant to become a part of you, to course through your veins, to be lived out. Something is written on your heart, and it's either your words or God's. Either your story or God's story. So may you find your place in God's story. May you delight in His Word. And may that Word be forever written on your heart.
Well, good morning, Bay Farm Church, and good morning to all of you who are visiting with us today. And happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there. I hope today that your family treats you well, gives you some presents, maybe some candy and flowers, or they just leave you alone for a couple hours. So you can go take a bath, eat a pint of Ben and Jerry's, or just, you know, go sleep in the car. But I just hope you have a great Mother's Day, and we are so glad you decided to join us today. We, this May, are talking about spiritual maturity. We're talking about how to grow up. And I have determined to give you the 5 C's to reaching spiritual maturity. Last week, we talked about how that you need to connect with God, and I gave you some different ways to do that. Today, we're going to talk about conforming to Scripture, and how that you need to allow God to transform you into a new person by using the Word of God. And so I'm going to try to help you understand that, at least from the Apostle Paul's point of view in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I want to encourage you to download the notes so you can follow along with me as I speak today. I also want you to block out all the distractions if you can in your household, and just take a few moments to give your life to God. Just take the next half hour and just focus in on what God has for you through His Word. I also want you to understand that this message is only going to be good for you. It's only going to be life-changing for you if you become a doer of the Word and not just a hearer. And so it's my prayer today that you will take all of this and you allow God to transform your life through His Word. I'm going to pray, then we're going to dive into this morning. Father, thank you so very much for a chance to study your Word today. Thank you for working in our lives. I thank you for the gift of salvation, eternal life through Jesus Christ. And I thank you for, Lord, working in our lives and growing us as Christians, sanctifying us, making us like Jesus. I pray, Father, that we could just work with you, partner with you, as we long to reach spiritual maturity. As I prayed last week, and probably throughout this series, we'll pray, Lord, help us to grow up. Help us to desire spiritual maturity, and help us to do what we need to do to be like Christ. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. After using 11 chapters to talk about what God has done for us, the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, pivoted to how we can be good Christians. Basically, Paul the Apostle, like he does or did in so many of his epistles, he talks in the first part of Romans about how God changed us from within, how He made us new people in Christ, new creations. And then he talks about, in a practical sense, how we can become like Jesus. And so, in Romans chapters 1 through 11, the Apostle Paul talks about all the stuff that God has done for us through His Son, Jesus Christ. And then in chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul gives a passionate plea and then a couple of clear commands to Christians. And that's really what we're going to talk about today in this very simple message. This is what Paul writes in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. He says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all He has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that He will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship Him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. And then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." What does the Apostle Paul say to Christians in Romans 12, 1 and 2? What I personally believe are some of the most important verses in the entire New Testament for Christians. What does he say to Christians in this very important portion of Scripture? Well, first of all, Paul begs us to give our bodies to God. He begs us to give our bodies to God. You can almost see the Apostle Paul getting down on his knees and reaching out with his arms, saying to each and every Christian, those who have trusted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, you can just see the old apostle reaching out and saying, "I beg you, I plead with you to surrender your body to God." The word "give" in verse 1 there of Romans 12, 1 is a military term. And the Apostle Paul was a great fan of using different types of language genres to explain great truths, to illustrate things that could be hard to understand. Many times he used farming illustrations. Many times he used sports illustrations. And then, of course, he used a lot of military terms because, again, it was a Roman Empire. But the word "give" is a military term that means to surrender without conditions. In Bible days, a defeated general would present his sword at the end of a war to the general that had defeated him. And in doing so, this presenting of one's sword signified that the contest of wills was over, that he was now surrendering himself over to whatever the victorious general would do to him. We saw such a presentation of a sword at the end of World War II when Japan surrendered to the Allied forces. On an aircraft carrier, a Japanese general surrendered his sword over to an American general. And the idea was unconditional surrender. We have lost the battle, and now we belong to you. Whatever you're going to do to us, we now accept. Well, the word "bodies" in verse 1 there of Romans 12, 1, it doesn't just mean your physical body. It means every part of your being, every part of you, your emotions, your feelings, your intellect, your hands, your feet, every part of you. When the Apostle Paul pleads with Christians in Romans 12, 1, to present their bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, he is saying, I want you to give every part of your being to the Lord, every part of you. Put all together, Paul is pleading with us, with Christians, to present or surrender themselves to God, to give God all that they are and all that they have or own. He wants us to unconditionally surrender ourselves to God. I've probably told my testimony a few thousand times in my life, but I want you to know, at the age of 17, this is the passage that changed my life, that caused me to give up on trying to find my own way in life and to truly, once and for all, surrender my will over to God's will. This is the portion of Scripture that God used, that the Holy Spirit used to grab me and to throw out all of my pride and my struggle for dominance and to surrender, to bow once and for all to Jesus, to give God every part of my being. Well, the question that a lot of Christians have after they hear Paul's passionate plea in Romans 12:1 is, why should Christians become living sacrifices to God? In a personal way, the question that we all have as Christians is, why should I give everything to the Lord? Why should I give up my will in order for God's will to be dominant in my life? Well, we should become living sacrifices to God because Jesus gave his life for us. In fact, if you study Romans 12:1 very closely, the Apostle Paul says, "So dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all that he has done for you." In the New King James Version, it says, "I want you to surrender your body as a living sacrifice to God because of his great mercies." Because of everything that God has done for you, you should give everything to the Lord. Jesus died on the cross for our sins so that we could be right with God and so that we could live right for God. Every Christian should present themselves to God as a living and holy, acceptable sacrifice to him out of gratitude for everything that God has done for us. I think the worst Christian is a Christian that is ungrateful, a Christian who is unthankful for all that God has done. And that's why I tell Christians all the time, you need to every day count your blessings, name them one by one, as the old hymn says. You need to count your blessings. You need to, when you go to God in prayer, instead of just reaching up and grabbing him by the collar and saying, "I want this," you need to take some time and you need to just thank the Lord for the food on your table, for the clothes on your body, for the place you're living, whether you like it or not. You need to thank him for the car you're driving or the bus you're riding in. You need to thank the Lord for your health. You need to thank the Lord for the people who love you. You need to thank the Lord for all he has given you, especially the great gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. Every day you need to contemplate the mercies of God, the mercy God has shown you, so that you become a grateful person and understand it's natural, it's reasonable to surrender your life to the Lord. Well, after he pleads with Christians to give every part of their lives to God, Paul then turns and he commands us not to conform to the world's ideas and behavior. The verb translated copy in Romans 12:2 comes from an interesting compound Greek word that means an outward expression that does not reflect what is within. The word was often used for actors in old Greece who systematically changed their outfits and their masks during a play in order to change their character. Understand the original Greek plays and actors were totally different than our actors today. Most of the time when you watch a movie or a television show today, an actor plays one part, maybe two parts. But in that day, back in Bible days, a Greek actor would play several roles within a play, change their voice and their actions, their mask and their outfit in order to play many different parts. The idea here is that when Paul says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world in the first part of verse 2 there, he is saying to Christians, don't allow this present world system, which was created and controls and is controlled by the devil, to shape you, to mold you into someone that you're not. You're a Christian. You should act like a Christian. You're a child of God. You should act like your father. It is unreasonable. It's unnatural. It's oxymoronic for a Christian, to a child of God, one filled with the Spirit of God, to act like a child of the devil. Bible scholar J.B. Phillips, he translates the first part of Romans 12:2 this way. He says, don't let the world around you squeeze you into its own mold. New Testament Greek scholar Kenneth Woost, he paraphrased Romans 12:2 in this way. It's kind of long, but you'll get it. Stop assuming an outward expression which is patterned after this world. An expression which does not come from nor is representative of what you are in your inner being as a regenerated child of God. Now, I know that's a lot to take in, but in his mind, he is breaking down the literal Greek phrase that the Apostle Paul is throwing out there, and he's saying, I want you to know, you've got to stop assuming this outward expression, which is patterned after the world, this world system that Satan, the God, small g, of this world created. He says, you got to quit doing that. It's not normal. That's not who you are on the inside. Let me dumb this down for you. And I like to do this for myself. If I was to translate the first part of Romans chapter 12, verse 2, I would translate it or paraphrase it this way. Children of God should not allow the devil to make them look or act like his kids. That's what Paul's saying. He's saying, don't allow Satan to conform you, to shape you, to push you. That whole idea of copy and conform or shape reminds me of when we were kids and we used to take Play-Doh and we used to put it in the little press, and then we put a figure or some sort of geometric figure on the outside of the press, and we would squeeze that lever down and the Play-Doh would squeeze through the mold and it would come out as a star or a half moon or a square or something like that. Well, Paul is basically saying, don't become Play-Doh, this clay in the hands of Satan. Don't allow him to take your life, put it in his world system, his mold, so he can shape you to look like one of his kids. Don't do that. Don't allow it to happen to you. Well, after he tells Christians how not to behave, Paul commands us to let God transform our thinking. The verb transform in the second half of Romans chapter 12, verse 2, comes from a Greek verb that simply means a total change from the inside out. It's where we get our English word metamorphosis. It means a complete change that begins from the inside and changes you then to the outside to be something totally different as a caterpillar becomes a butterfly. Well, as Christians, we are not to allow the world to shape our ideas, our behavior, our whole belief system. But we are to allow God to use the Bible to transform our thinking so that we can become new people, godly people, people who are Christ-like. I like what the Apostle Paul writes in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. And I want to read it to you out of the Message Bible or paraphrase because I think it does a good job of really explaining how the Scripture changes us or can change us. Paul writes, every part of Scripture is God-breathed, and it is useful one way or another, showing us truth, exposing our rebellion, correcting our mistakes, training us to live God's way. Through the Word, we are put together and shaped up for the task God has for us. So what's Paul saying? He's saying, as we study the Bible, we learn what is right. We learn the truth, not what Satan is trying to tell us the truth is, but we learn what the real truth is. We learn what truth is. And then we also learn as we study the Bible what is not right. What is not acceptable thinking? What is not acceptable speech or communication? What is not acceptable action or behaviors? We also learn how to get right, how to change the course of our lives, how we can find that we're going the wrong way and change to the right way, how we can get off the wrong track and get on the right track. But the Word of God also tells us how to stay right. It corrects our life, and as we truly embrace it and we truly embody the Word of God, we become doers of the Word, not just hearers only. When that happens, when the Word of God sinks into our life and permeates every part of our being, then we can truly live the life God created us to live. We can do we can do the tasks that God has shaped us for. The Word of God shows us how to think and act the way God wants us to think and act. It renews our sinful minds, and it makes us like Jesus. I said at the beginning of this message that spiritual maturity is a process, and it is. Anyone who thinks that someone receives Jesus Christ as their Savior, they become a Christian, and they immediately are a different person, they don't understand Christianity at all. The truth is, when a person receives Jesus Christ as their Savior, and they're born again by the Spirit of God, and the Holy Spirit takes residence in their life, there's a dramatic change. They are a new person, but they're a new person on the inside. Practically speaking, on the outside, they've got a lot of stuff that has to change. You see, when a person becomes a Christian, they've got to trade out all their wrong beliefs, all of their wrong communication and actions and thoughts, all their wrong behavior. They've got to trade that out. And that process of practically becoming like Jesus, thinking, feeling, and acting like Christ, that is where spiritual maturity really comes in. As we think about this process of spiritual maturity, you have to understand that it all comes from here. There are a lot of people who think that they can change a habit or a behavior by just willpower, or just by, hey, I'm not going to do that anymore. That's the wrong way of living. That's hurtful, so on. But I want you to know, it doesn't work that way. The only way to get rid of a bad habit is to trade it for a good habit. The only way to get rid of a wrong thought is to trade it for a right thought. The only way to get rid of all the lies that Satan has preached to you and taught, tried to get you to accept. The only way to get rid of all that garbage in your mind that you've put there as a sinner before you became a Christian is to trade it out, to renew your mind, your thinking. Because from your beliefs comes your thinking, from your thinkings comes your feeling, and from your thinking and feelings come your behavior. It all begins with the mind. Wrong beliefs about things like honesty and confrontation and forgiveness and submission, they have to be traded for right beliefs, the right beliefs that are found in God's Word. And that's how God is that's His plan for spiritual maturity, is to renew our minds, our thinking, so that we truly think and feel and act like Christ. As He puts the Word of God into our life and we accept it and we conform to it, then we change and we become the kind of people we want to become. Well, what happens to Christians who surrender their body and mind to God? What happens to them? Well, according to Apostle Paul, surrendered Christians learn that God's will is good, pleasing, and perfect. Again, let me read to you Romans 12:1-2, whole thing again. He says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, my fellow Christians, I plead, I beg with you to give your bodies to God because of all He has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind He will find acceptable or pleasing. This is truly the way to worship God. It is truly an act of service towards God." He goes on in verse 2, "Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world system, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think." Then again, at the end here, he says, if you allow God, if you surrender your body and mind to God, this is what happens. "Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." The Apostle Paul here at the very end, the last part of Romans chapter 12, verse 2, he tells us that as we surrender our bodies and our minds, our complete being over to God, and we allow Him to do His work of sanctification or making us spiritually mature, as we allow Him to work in our life through the conviction of the Spirit, as well as through the Word of God renewing our minds, then God's will becomes different to us. God's will for the surrendered Christian is good. We see it as good. We don't see going to church as something that is, hard to do. We don't see that reading God's Word is hard to do. We don't see that treating people with love and respect is hard to do, or it's bad, or it's wrong, or it's unjustifiable. What we see is that God's will is good. It's always good. We also see that God's will is godly, or it's pleasing to Him. It honors Him. It glorifies Him. And ultimately, that is the goal of the Christian life. That is the real reason why God saves us, is so that we can give Him glory. But also, we see that as you surrender your body and mind to God, the surrendered Christian sees that God's will is complete in every way. I wish I had a lot more time to spend on this one point, but you're smart enough to think about this week. As you continually surrender your body and mind to the Lord, you surrender your life to Him, you present yourself as a living sacrifice to Him each and every day. As you do that, you come to the place where you realize that God's will is all you need. It's all you need. You don't need to run after your own will, or you don't need to conform to the will of Satan in this world system. You don't need to listen to someone else tell you how to live. You start looking and seeing life as through, hey, this is what God wants me to do. And you know what? That's everything I need to do. That is complete and it's perfect. When I do God's will, I have truly experienced and will continue to experience the best life. The best life. Let me close by putting all this in a nutshell, or just breaking it down for you really quickly. The devil wants to conform you to his ideas and behavior. But as a Christian, you need to allow God to transform you into a new person. As Paul did some 2,000 years ago, I today want to plead with you that you just surrender today to God. As a Christian, one who has received Christ as your Savior, I plead with you today that you will surrender your body and your mind to the Lord and allow Him to use His Word to transform you into Christ. I can't do that for you. Your wife or your husband can't do that for you. Your pastor can't force you to do it. Someone else can't talk you or persuade you, convince you to do it. No one can surrender your life for you. It's something you have to do. Something you have to do. like receiving Jesus Christ was your personal choice. We sometimes call it receiving Christ as your personal Savior. It's your personal choice to receive Christ as your Savior, to become a child of God. Well, it's your personal choice whether you're going to allow God to work in your life every day and making you like Jesus. I plead with you today as Paul did. Give up your will. Give up your plans. Give up your ideas and beliefs. Give up your goals in life. Give all that up and say, God, I belong to you. So now I'm just handing my life to you and trusting that your will is good and pleasing and perfect. And I guarantee you, if you'll do that, you'll see that Paul's words are true. I want to pray for you today, but before I do, I want you to know if you haven't received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can today. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you've done. I don't care if you consider yourself a good person or a really bad person. I don't care. The Bible tells us that anyone can come to Christ. How do you do it? How do you become a Christian? Well, A, you have to agree with God that you're a sinner. You have to agree with God you're a sinner. You have to admit your sin and say to God, yeah, I need you. I need to be saved. B, you have to believe that Jesus is a Savior, that the plan of salvation is the gospel of Jesus Christ. God sent His Son some 2,000 years ago to die on the cross for your sins. Jesus, the Son of God, died for you, was buried, and rose again so that you could be made right with God. You have to believe in your head and in your heart that Jesus is the Savior. And as a drowning person, someone drowning in your sins, you have to call out to the Savior. A, agree with God you're a sinner. B, believe Jesus is the Savior. C, call upon the Savior for salvation. For the Scripture says in the book of Romans, chapter 10, whoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you haven't received Christ as your Savior, I encourage you to do that today. Don't let another day go by. Accept the mercies of God. Reach out for eternal life through Jesus Christ. Jesus has died for you, and there is nothing whatsoever that you can do to be saved. All you can do as a sinner is reach out for Christ. Receive that gift that He's offering you today. I encourage you to do that. And I also encourage you that if you receive Christ today, that you would just send us a quick email and tell us, hey, you know what, I received Christ today. So we can send you a Bible, so we can give you some discipleship materials, so we can try to help you understand the Word of God and try to get you moving in the Christian life the way you should. Right now, I want to take just a second and pray for everyone today. I want to pray about the message as well as pray that you will have a week of surrender, a week where you truly, truly allow God to conform your thinking with His Word. Lord, thank you for all you've given us. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for giving us your written Word to teach us the truth and to correct us and to show us how to live and show us how not to live. I thank you, Lord, that you are working in our lives. You're shaping us to be like your Son. And you have promised that you will complete this one day. You will glorify us in heaven. I thank you for all that, Lord. I pray for Christians today that they would bend their will to your will. They would surrender their lives totally to you so that you can conform them to Scripture, that you can change them and transform them into a new person that looks like your Son. Then they will recognize that your will is good, pleasing, and perfect. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The song we're going to close with today is a powerful reminder that Jesus Christ is our cornerstone. He is the one who is the foundation of all things. He's the one that we worship. We can put our trust in Him. We can put our hope in Him. In Christ alone, we sing this song. that He is our cornerstone. We invite you to sing with us today. Is Christ alone, cornerstone, weakness?
Savior's love through the storm. He is the Lord, He's the Lord of all. One more time, Christ alone.
Thank you everyone for joining us today on this beautiful Sunday. We hope you enjoyed service, and we hope to see you every Sunday at 10 a.m. with us online.
And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there.
I see.
promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.